Welcome. My name is Yiannis Koukouras. I am the managing director of 12sec. I've been a penetration tester for almost 15 years. I have a bunch of certifications, which don't mind here. I'm a very eager cyber community supporter. And today, we're going to talk about an assessment that we did in 12sec for a secure laptop built for off-site work. So we are going to talk about the methodology that we used, the different vulnerabilities, the different misconfigurations we found, bugs, race conditions, some 0 days that we found. And we're going to show how we use those to exfiltrate data of this secure laptop and tap into the corporate network. So first, we got this laptop. Supposedly, it was built with security in mind from scratch. It was for people to work away from the corporate environment. It had Windows 10 fully updated on it. It had an endpoint security solution, which included a firewall, antivirus, anti-malware, and IPSec VPN client. The Windows firewall was disabled, as most of the administrators do, in order not to confuse the other firewall. It had a full disk encryption with pre-boot authentication. It had uplocker on whitelist mode on the default settings. It had a fully virtualized internet access, so that meant that as long as the user would browse the intranet of the corporation with their Internet Explorer, Internet Explorer worked just fine. As soon as they entered a URL that would go outside of the network on a public URL, then Internet Explorer would close. A virtualized instance of a browser would pop up, and then they would be able to browse through there. They wouldn't be able to download anything, they wouldn't be able to upload anything, and as soon as they closed the browser, the instance will be deleted. The configuration on the laptop was that BIOS was locked, all the boot devices other than the hardware, than the hard drive was locked, all the USB ports, cameras, microphones, everything was locked on the BIOS. Cache credentials were enabled on the laptop, but only for only domain users were allowed to log in, no local users. So, what they used in this corporation, it was the World Garden architecture, which is proposed by the GCHQ, the NSA of the Brits. What we have here is we have this laptop in question, and it has two modes. One mode is when it's inside the corporate network, and one when it's outside. So at boot time, prior decrypting anything, it will send a heartbeat to a specific internal server. If he would get a reply, that meant that the laptop is inside the network, so it would automatically decrypt and prompt the user to log in to the domain. If no reply was received by this internal server, that meant that the laptop is outside the corporate network, so it will go to the outside mode. In this mode, it would ask for the login credentials of the domain of the user, which were cached, in order to start the decryption of the hardware. And then it would automatically sign on the user to the Windows environment. At that point, the VPN client will try to identify this VPN gateway, this public IP address. If it could find it, then it will connect to it, and the firewall would apply a policy. Okay, we are inside the network, allow all connections to internal IP addresses, deny everything public. If the VPN client could not find the VPN gateway, then it will go to another mode that's saying, okay, we deny everything. The firewall denies all communication at all. So you wouldn't be able to send files outside the corporate network, they wouldn't be able to attack you, everything like that. And all this, money, all this architecture design, all this trouble was done for one single thing, for the employees of the company to be able to do that. So the scope of our work was to try to, if we could, implant malware on the laptop or use it to expand to the rest of the internal network, get access to the laptop from an unsecured network, like for example, someone is connected to a hotspot, internet cafe, to a co-working space, into his home unsecured network, whatever. Maybe use this access to gain access to the corporate network of the client. And if we try to see if a legitimate user that has access to the laptop can exfiltrate information of the organization outside the organization. At that point, some smarty pants always say, okay, what if we take photos? What if we memorize the data? Okay, this goes out of scope. This can always be done. So, what we did first, we set up a lab, two virtual machines. The first one was to be emulating the laptop. It had Windows 10, it had the endpoint solution, the whole suite. This is internals, mainly for the procmon and access check tools. The second VM was constructed in order to be the gateway of the laptop, of the first VM. So it had Kali Linux with the DHCP daemon on, IP tables in order to for the machine to act as a gateway, the responder on with WPAD server on, and WireShark, of course. So, before I move on to the testing, any questions on the configuration? Okay. So, we started to see how this VM was behaving. The first thing we noticed was that during boot time, due to the driver of the firewall being loaded late on the process, it would start leaking local domain names of the organization, trying to connect to different parts of the organization until the firewall driver kicked in and they stopped. Another thing, during the DHCP negotiations, this is a standard behavior for a DHCP client, there were some leakage of the local domain name, host name, excuse me. And the third thing, which was the most weird one, was that when the laptop was connected to the VPN, all the DNS calls were broadcasted into all network devices, and the firewall would allow them. So we get internal domain names of the organization. You can see here a Wireshark screenshot. We got the host name of the laptop, a specific packet from DHCP negotiation. And we got all kinds of different domain names for internal systems. Here we see the responder running, getting all these requests and trying to poison them. However, due to the firewall policy, all these poison attempts were blocked. So we moved on and said, okay, let's see how this suite is, how securely it's developed. So we searched through WMIC, service enumeration, PowerShell service enumeration, to see if there were unquoted service paths. Unfortunately, we didn't find any. However, when we ran the procmon tool from sysinternals, we saw that the service was trying to execute C program, C program Excel, secret program files, and so on. So it seemed that even though the service path was quoted, within the application itself, there were some calls to some executables that were unquoted. So what we did, create C program Excel, restarted the service, and sure enough, our program Excel was executed. The other thing that we noticed is that when we did that, restarting of the service took quite a lot of time, like 20 seconds. So this got us suspicious, and then what we did, we restarted the service again, and as soon as we got this pop-up, remember now, we were not connected on the VPN, so the firewall policy was deny all. Don't allow anything incoming or outgoing. So we did this. Ping Google's DNS, and it worked for like 15 seconds. So for like 15 seconds, while the service was starting, it would allow all incoming outgoing collections. This is a classic case of race condition. It failed open. As soon as the service failed, no firewall at all. Another thing we checked was the blocker rules. So we ran access check of these internals, and we saw that all these paths had both read and execute permissions on the system. By the way, most of them, except the last two ones, all the other are the default configuration of AppLocker. And probably these were added by the administrator in order for Altiris to work. So, we already knew that developers didn't really care about race conditions, that there were some issues with the software, it was leaking, and it really didn't handle well exceptions. So what we did, we went to the gateway VM and played with access to the VPN gateway, turn it on, off, again. So as soon as we changed the status of the VPN connection, we saw on the responder that our poisonous DNS poisoning has worked, and we got started getting hashes from the system. And this again happened for like 10 to 12 seconds. So what happened here? The firewall had two rules, two policies. One, when it's connected on the VPN, and when it's not connected. What he did here, when he changed policy, he would clear all the rules, even the deny all rule, the last one, and then reapply the new rules. So there was a window of a few seconds that there was no rule at all, so it was practically any. So, using this information, try to get access to the laptop. On the second VM, we set up a web server with a fully undetectable reverse shell. And we changed the status of the VPN gateway connectivity. We had a PowerShell script ready in order to have the time to do that in 50 seconds, which downloaded and executed the reverse shell. And sure enough, we got access. The first one was a scenario from an internal user that has access to the laptop and wants to be able to get access to get the data out of the laptop. The second scenario, social engineering. So if we control the gateway, like having a fake access point or whatever else scenario, then we just turn the responder on with WPAD server on. Wait. For the user to connect to the VPN and wait for internal DNS requests. And at that point, we close the connection to the gateway. And then we have this window, this 12-second window, 15-second window for our responder to execute the WPAD poisoning and redirect the user to our own page and prompt him to download the reverse shell on one of the paths that we before saw on the AppLocker that are write and execute, and ask him to execute it. And of course, get the shell back. However, the problem here was that we have this 15-second window only, and after that, the new policy will be applied, the one that said we are outside the network, the VPN network, so deny all. And we will lose all our connections. So how to maintain access? What we did was re-enable the connection to the VPN gateway. The VPN client connected back. So the firewall said, OK, we are back in. policy allow only internal IP connectivity. We had an internal IP, so there is a reverse reconnected. So at that moment, we had not only access to the laptop, but because the laptop was connected to the VPN, we had a pivot point to the whole corporate network. The reason for this happening was that when the policy was applied, the new policy was applied on the firewall, the connection state table was not flushed. So the connection was there, getting denied all the time. As soon as the new policy was applied, it reconnected back. So this architecture effectively came to become this. So to recap, we found DNS leakage on the preboot, on the DHCP, on the VPN. Uncoded service paths, uncoded exceptions, non-graceful termination, race conditions on the policy and network status change, failure to flush the connection states, WPAD was enabled, so we could do the social engineering scenario, default rules for the app blocker, and all this can be fixed by, of course, upgrading the firewall. We have already submitted this information to the vendor, so they will be fixing it soon, so then we will be releasing this information under five different CVEs. So they have to mitigate the race conditions, improve the loading time of the firewall driver on the boot, flush the connection states on VPN VPN change, fail close, when fail, just deny all. When changing from one policy to another, first deny all and then reapply all the other rules. Deny broadcast requests, so to avoid DNS leakage. Enclose all paths, even into the application code with double quotes. And of course, when enabling a blocker, don't rely on the on the default configuration, use the WXOR principle. Only paths that have write access cannot have execute, and vice versa. And another thing is to avoid single point of failures, enable Windows Firewall. It won't mess up with the other firewall. It will be there as a redundancy. And of course, everybody should tune in for the five CVs when they are released in order to update. Any questions? Thank you.